Good evening. The weekend now starts here. Tomorrow's world has travelled back in time, and in a moment we'll prove that time travel is a real possibility. Whatever happens to all those car tyres? You can tell it's bonfire now. Some go to tyre hell, some go to tyre heaven. And what about skydiving without a parachute and how to survive it? Well, you've guessed, it is November the 5th, and we found a pretty good excuse for some fireworks! But first, time travel!
We're not of this race. We're not of this Earth. We are wanderers in the fourth dimension of space and time. Cut off from our own planet and our own people by eons and universes, far beyond the reach of your most advanced sciences.
It's true, every word of it's true.
For 30 years, the TARDIS has given the Doctor the power to travel through time, more or less at the push of a button. It's just a shame that time machines are science fiction. Or are they? In fact, at this very moment, we're all travelling into the future at the rate of 1 second per second. OK, that's a smarty-pants answer. But what would be exciting is to leap way into the future, ahead of everybody else. And that's not as difficult as it sounds. It's just a question of travelling very, very fast. And it's been done, using two very accurate cesium clocks, one on the ground and one in a plane. After 15 hours of travelling at 250 miles an hour, the flying clock returned to Earth to find it had leapt into the future by 6 whole billionths of a second. So the flying clock, the plane, and everybody in it actually experienced less time than the clock on the ground. With it? Well, that's all explained by Einstein's theory of relativity and the fact that the speed of light is always constant. It never changes, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Imagine you're on a plane and you shine a beam of light from the top of the plane to the bottom. What you see is this. It's a vertical line. Now, I'm standing on the ground. This is the crucial bit. I'm standing here on the Earth watching the plane go past. And I see this. The beam has travelled from the top to the bottom, but it's also travelled forward. It's at an angle and it's a bit longer. So, as far as I'm concerned, the light has travelled further. And because the speed of light always remains the same, if the light went further, it must have taken longer. Yeah? So that means more time has passed for me here on the Earth than for the people on the plane. And the faster they go, the more dramatic the effect. If they flew at close to the speed of light and travelled for a single day, they would return to Earth, to a future Earth, in the year 2093. But what about travelling into the past? Well, changing the direction of time itself is actually quite tricky. But over the years, there have been some ideas. And it all started a few years back, according to the first presenter of Tomorrow's World, Raymond Baxter.
There's renewed interest in time travel. And it's all because science fiction writer Carl Sagan wants more realism in his books. His physicist friends are suggesting some fairly outlandish methods for travelling back in time. Well, today, in 1993, a year or two later, those ideas about time travel have become respectable.
Amazingly enough, calculations by physicists have shown that you can go backwards in time as well as forwards. Einstein's equations allows things to exist called wormholes. These are like tunnels which can connect one part of space to another or one part of time to another. If you have a wormhole, you can go in at one mouth of the wormhole, then go through the wormhole and out at the other mouth at an earlier time. Now, fortunately, we don't have to build things like this in a factory. They could exist out there in space naturally.
Well, in fact, no one has yet found one. But supposing they did, we could get into quite a muddle. What would stop me sometime in the future coming back in time to now and shooting myself? But if I'm killed, I would no longer be around to go forward again to where I was. Well, according to Professor Clark, the laws of physics will always prevent such paradoxes.
In the case of that time traveller, what might happen would be that when he shot himself, his hand would waver and he would graze himself, giving himself a flesh wound. And then when the wounded traveller went back in time, that flesh wound would cause his hand to waver, so everything is consistent. It might seem weird and peculiar, but near a wormhole, the laws of physics are so warped that something always happens to prevent the paradoxes.
Avoid paradoxes, and if you can find a wormhole, some physicists still believe that tunnels through time would be impossible to use.
Einstein's general theory of relativity allows wormholes and the possibility of travel into the past. However, work that I and other people have done indicates that radiation will build up infinitely near wormholes. This would provide a physical obstacle. This led me to propose that the laws of physics will always conspire to prevent travel into the past. It would be nice if we could travel in time, for then we could indeed see tomorrow's world today. But I think we have evidence that time travel is not possible, and never will be. Otherwise, we would have been invaded by hordes of tourists from the future.
Skydiving is a scary sport at the best of times, but imagine skydiving without a parachute. This is the Aerodium, an open-air wind tunnel. It was designed to help skydivers improve their technique, but it's become America's latest theme park experience. It was built by daredevil engineer Scott Albushcat.
Underneath the net is a wind tunnel. The heart of the wind tunnel is a DC-3 aircraft propeller, which is pushing up the air with a speed of 100 miles an hour.
But how do you get a wind tunnel when there isn't a sort of a tunnel around it?
Well, Kate, this is our secret engineering. We spent a lot of time and money in that, and I can't tell you that. But if you like, why don't you have a go?
I can have a go at flying.
You can fly with us right away. Come on, we get you dressed.
Brilliant.
Looking out forward.
Yeah.
Stomach flat.
Stomach in.
The legs. Not bending the knees too much, keeping everything straight.
Straight.
Straight like that. Keeping your stomach flat. Just be nice and relaxed.
Relaxed. Ugh. Now, come on, Kate, pull yourself together. Remember the Bernoulli effect. An object can be safely trapped in an airstream because the air goes faster in the middle than on the outside. So the pressure is less in the centre than it is round the edge. Well, that's all very well for ping pong balls, but what about Bellingham's? But I can tell you that it's not as easy as it looks. So I'm going to leave the stunts to the real high flyers. Take a look at this.
Last year, the number of babies dying from cot death in Britain has halved after a simple change in advice. Babies should be put to sleep on their backs instead of their fronts. The news that this makes a difference is so reassuring for parents.
Knowing that there is something I can do to reduce the risk of cot death has made me much more relaxed as a mother. We still lie in bed listening to her breathing and prodding her occasionally when she's too quiet, but we at least know that we're doing everything we possibly can to reduce the risk.
But we mustn't forget that the problem of cot death isn't solved. Every week, 12 babies still die unexpectedly in their sleep. And no one fully understands why, or even why putting a baby on its back should make such a difference. But doctors in Manchester are putting forward a theory which they think sheds light on both those questions.
People have long suspected that infection was important in cot death. But when you look for the sort of organisms, the viruses and the bacteria, that cause serious disease in adults, you don't find them. What you do find are a whole range of common organisms which are considered to be harmless. And because they're harmless, they've been ignored.
These common bacteria are harmless to adults because we have fully developed immune systems which can fight them off. But a baby's immune system doesn't get up to its full strength until the baby is about a year old. The Manchester team wondered if this means that sometimes young babies can't cope with these normally harmless bacteria. It could be that the bacteria multiply and flood the baby's body with dangerous toxins.
And the white ones are Staph aureus. So what are the others? Are they pneumococcal? We have found in cot death babies more bacteria and different types of bacteria than you find in normal babies of about the same age.
And there was more. They found evidence that some babies who died from cot death had been exposed to such high levels of toxin that their immune systems had been overwhelmed. But these bacteria are very common. Most of us and most babies have them harmlessly in the nose and throat. So what makes the bacteria and their toxins increase to a level that overcomes the baby's resistance? One reason might be a cold or a mild viral infection. And this might also explain why a baby is safer on its back than on its front. To test this, the researchers asked adults with colds to lie on their fronts for an hour at a time.
Right, that's an hour. How are you feeling?
A bit stuffed up.
Can you sit up for me, please?
They found that lying face down created a warm, sticky environment around the nose and mouth, which did encourage the bacteria to grow.
The essential thing in cot death is that infection by bacteria puts the baby at risk of dying. And anything that tips the balance in favour of the bacteria increases that risk. So if the baby has a viral infection, that increases the risk. If the baby lies on its front, that increases the risk. If the baby gets too hot, that increases the risk. And if the baby's in a smoky atmosphere, that increases the risk.
What makes this theory so persuasive is that it offers an explanation for many of the things we know reduce the chance of babies dying from cot death. There is probably more than one cause of cot death, but if this theory proves to be correct, then it might be possible in the future to act on it by boosting the baby's immune system. In the meantime, though, parents who want detailed advice should write to this address. The Foundation for the Study of Infant Deaths, 35 Belgrave Square, London, Southwest 1X, 8QB. That's the Foundation for the Study of Infant Deaths, 35 Belgrave Square, London, Southwest 1X, 8QB. And the best practical advice is to reduce all the known risk factors. Don't smoke, make sure the baby doesn't get too hot, and of course, put your baby to sleep on its back.
Some animals are more equal than others. The Dutch are using radio tags to track their prize porkers from suckling to sausage. The tags can keep track of anything that moves, like clothes in a laundry, which have a nasty habit of getting mixed up. Now some factories in America are thinking about sewing the tags into their workers' overalls. If you can track the garment, you can track the worker.
Great heavens! two more traces.
Should you want to, you could follow your workers anywhere. Could be useful for the chicken plucking company, which wants to time how long its workers spend on comfort breaks.
I'll watch him rest, and I'll watch him work. If he works as good as he rests, we might keep him on.
One British company is already fitting the tags into identity badges, for security only, of course. John Major, take note. The PM wants IDs ASAP. With electronic tags, it would be possible to know the exact whereabouts of all 55 million of us.
You might very well think that. You know I couldn't possibly comment.
One of the things that it's impossible to predict when ideas are featured on Tomorrow's World is their impact. At Christmas time 1973, I demonstrated a completely new idea, a game called, would you believe,
Each
Pong.
Player has two main controls. This one moves his man on the screen vertically, this one horizontally, and this reset button serves. You ready, Jen? Play. 15 love.
My daughter maintains to this day that she won, but the rest, as they say, is history. 20 years on, video games have come of age with slightly better names and certainly more enticing graphics. But the next big assault on your wallets will probably come from a relative of this. Virtual reality games are set to shrink, move out of the arcade and into our homes.
Virtual reality, or VR as it's known in short, puts you in a completely artificial world. And this headset excludes everything else. And as I turn my head, the virtual world turns with it. It's quite amazing. Well, we first showed you virtual reality back in 1990, and already arcade versions are gaining in popularity, and opening up the domestic market could really clinch it. But recently, newspaper articles have made all sorts of claims about the dangers of VR, from nausea to double vision. In fact, one paper called it virtual insanity. Bit of an exaggeration, perhaps. But there is research which found that some people tested on certain systems, like this one used by the Army for research, complained of vision problems after just a few minutes in a virtual world. Not all VR machines are the same, though, so are the problems due to particular designs of equipment? Well, the research did suggest that it was very important for the two screens to be accurately positioned and lined up for each person's eyes. But another theory says that some people's eyes just can't deal with VR itself. Now, normally, if I'm looking at something very close up, my eyes have to work very hard to focus, and they sort of converge, they cross over to stop double vision. So there's a relationship between where my eyes focus and how cross-eyed I go. Well, in virtual reality, that relationship can break down. Let's go into this virtual world, and I'll show you what I mean. If you look down on the front there. If I go towards these chess pieces, then as they come towards me, my eyes would converge, but the focus point remains the same because I'm just looking at a screen. Maybe it's clear if I look over the edge of this platform. Ooh. Now those chess pieces down there look to me to be a long way away, so naturally my eyes would diverge, but of course the image is still coming from the same point on the screen. So perhaps this is what's causing all those problems. Of course, it's very difficult to test because you can't really see what the eyes are actually doing when you're wearing a helmet like this. Well, now the health and safety executive are spending £200,000 to find if it really does happen and also if it is a real problem. Because in fact, some eye specialists that we've spoken to say VR should be okay for people with normal eyesight. But it's a new technology. Nobody actually knows what could happen when one of the big players, Sega, starts selling cheaper domestic handsets next year. At the moment, there's an obvious limit to how much time you can spend on a VR machine. Money. A few minutes on one of these will set you back a couple of pounds. And that's going to change. Once you've got VR at home, you can use it as long as you like. The only limit left will be the boredom factor.
What When you buy new tyres, the garage conveniently gets rid of the old ones for you. Some are remoulded, a few are shredded and used for carpet underlay and other things, but most are just dumped.
250 million scrap tyres are piled up or buried all over the country, and every year, millions more are added to the tips. They're ugly, they contaminate the land, and sometimes they catch fire. And when they do, they're poisonous, dangerous, and very hard to put out. Burning tyres above ground can take weeks to control. Burning tyres underground, rather longer. I'm standing on several million burning tyres. There's not much to see, but I can certainly smell it. The fire's been smouldering away under here for 4 years, and right now a team of engineers are trying to work out what to do about it. Until 1989, this valley on the Welsh borders was used as a perfectly legal dump without any fuss. Then it caught fire. Oil and chemicals from the melting tyres were carried downstream, and water supplies 50 miles away had to be shut down. So the fire was smothered by heaping earth on top. But out of sight doesn't mean out of mind. Although most of the tar is now caught in traps, the pollution levels still have to be monitored every couple of weeks. But everyone's biggest worry is that the land could become unstable and the whole thing flare up and go dangerously out of control, spreading toxic fumes for miles. So the engineers are trying to map out which areas are burning and at what depth, but without disturbing the ground.
Now, we're getting traces of explosive gases.
Gas samples from all around the site give a fair idea of what's happening near the surface. But oddly enough, the best way to get a general picture of burning depths is from high above, at night. A helium balloon carrying an infrared camera is floated over the site to record the hot spots.
Okay, it's on maximum now, 200 feet.
Now they can actually see which areas are still burning. Gosh, that is really bright.
Well, I mean, obviously you can see you've got about 1, 2, 3 really hot spots in the centre of the fire.
Is that about where I saw it smoking before?
Probably.
Yeah.
This area here is a new hot spot that hasn't been seen before. Mm. It seems to suggest that the fire is actually migrating across the site.
Oh, dear.
We can see here that it's right hard onto the boundaries of the site.
From all this, the engineers can work out what the fire's doing underground and the likely dangers. But sooner or later, someone's got to decide what action to take. One plan is to divert the watercourse away from the site and block off its present pathway, which would at least limit the damage. And another more ambitious plan is to inject the whole site with liquid nitrogen and freeze out the fire. Just one thing against that, though, the mere matter of £4 million. No one's got it. But perhaps the most worrying thing is that this tip was legal and listed. Most aren't. So no one knows how many more fires like this are just waiting to happen. But if the bad news is that tyres burn, the good news is that tyres burn. Burning tyres can generate electricity. And from next week, Eileen Parks, along with 25,000 other households in Wolverhampton, will be getting all her electricity from a completely new power station. It's fueled entirely by used tyres. Using an idea that comes from America, the tyres are burnt without causing any pollution. The process depends on a series of furnaces, operating at higher and higher temperatures to destroy unwanted pollutants along with the rubber. Steam from the boilers above is piped off to the generators to produce the electricity. What's left can all be recycled. The smoke contains valuable zinc, which will go into new tyres. The remaining fumes are converted into calcium salts used in industry. After that, all that remains is lots of highly saleable steel wire and clean air. When it opens next week, this power station will be taking nearly a quarter of Britain's used tyres. Two smaller plants are already planned for Scotland and the south. But although these power stations will make a huge dent in future tyre dumps, they can't help us get rid of the old ones.
Many of the existing dumps are contaminated with other forms of waste. We cannot put that through our process. Most of the other recycling processes can't deal with that either. Those probably will be shredded, made into smaller pieces, and put into landfill.
So who pays?
On illegal tips, I'm sure the responsibility is going to have to go to the local authority. If they can go and find who really dumped the tires, they can take action to those people. But I think the taxpayers in the United Kingdom are going to end up paying. I don't think you'll ever get a 100% solution to the waste tire problem until the consumer decides that it's their problem. The customer has got to pay attention to where their old tires go for there to be a difference.
Any solution will involve heavy costs, but unless one is found, our landscape will be spoiled by these dumps for a very long time.
Well, it's bonfire night, so we're bound to have fireworks, aren't we? We always have fireworks. And the news is new colours. The dramatic bursts of coloured stars that you see in the sky actually come from these dull little pellets. In fact, each one of these is a mini bomb made from concoctions of dry powders that do the ignition, fuel and colour. And they've been mixed very carefully by hand and then dried out in ovens. And it turns out that some colours are more dangerous to handle than others. Apparently the chemicals for blue and purple stars make a particularly explosive mix. Great for fireworks, bad for the people who have to bake them. So enter a new firework making machine which uses a new, safer fireworks recipe. Now, instead of all the old powders, the new mix includes a cocktail of resins. And all I need to do now is add a bit of a catalyst, and that hardens it instead of cooking it in an oven. And the machine can be trusted to mix all that up without any explosions. And anyway, because it's automatic, the operator can always be well away if the sparks do decide to fly. And it means that they'll now be able to experiment with the mixtures to produce a brighter and more daring range of colours. Well, it's time to practice your ooze, because here goes the first batch. Enjoy Bonfire.
Practice your arms as well, if I were you, Howard, because last night, Howard's wife, Lizanne, gave birth to a little girl. 6 pounds, 4 ounces. Name?
With Shelby Elizabeth.
Mother.
There, that's a decision. It
Mother.
Has to be now.
Shelby and Daddy are going to do very well.
I'm very proud.
I'm very proud.
And surprised.
Have a good night, and a mega weekend.